School, where my children attended. One is now 25 and one will turn 23 in 2 weeks. And it's always good to come back here and see a couple of the teachers, Phil Lynch and Carrie Black. They're both teaching here with my kids attending. So it's great to be back. Our first order of business tonight is public comment. If there's anybody in the audience who wishes to speak now on any issue that's not on the agenda, please make yourself known. Okay, seeing no one. Our next order of business is a student report. And tonight we have Dan Madden. He's from the class of 2017, so he has 3 days of school left. And Dan will be leaving us. This is his last report. Thank him for all his service. He's been a great student reporter for us. The student council, the student representative, is really important in the school committee because it keeps us in touch with what's going on, especially at the high school. And so I want to thank Dan and the other seniors who've given us great reports all year.
Appreciate it. Thank you. For those in the audience tonight, my name is Dan Madden. I'm a senior at North Reading High School, currently serving my second year as a student representative to the school committee member at large. This will be my last report tonight. So heading into June here at North Reading High School, and as a senior, there's a lot going on, but also not a lot going on at the same time. In the Fine Arts Department at North Reading High School, the elections took place last week for the student representatives to the school committee, student council representatives, and also class officers. Someone who's partaken in student council in the past 4 years, it was excellent to see a high turnout from all grades. Upwards of 35 kids from the class of 2020, I believe, running for student council for 15 positions. So it's excellent to see that such a high amount of student involvement in North Reading High School is taking place each and every day. An academics final exam started today for the seniors. Our last day of school will be June 2nd, followed by the baccalaureate graduation taking place on June 4th in the high school, which will be sponsored by local businesses, which will produce a high turnout of the class of 2017. June 5th, prom will be held at the Burlington Marriott for the senior class, and also for the first time this year, we will have our grand march at North Reading High School instead of Ipswich River Park, which will be nice, being that the weather is consistently 50 degrees and cloudy around the home of June. We'll be able to just walk our way to the high school. And June 9th will be graduation at, I believe, 6:15 at North Reading High School. Hopefully, like I said, outside. Who really knows with this weather? Last week we had a mock car crash held by SAD and Masters in North Reading High School, which is to promote safety in regards to driving. It was really breathtaking, and it was quite a spectacle to see the promoted safety when it comes to teenagers and drinking and driving and also doing drugs. We also like to thank SAD and Masters for doing that for the juniors and senior classes, and also to North Reading Police Department and also Fire Department, who helped sponsor the event to promote to teens what safe driving really means. Yearbook signing will take place next Wednesday for the senior class inside the North Reading High School, which will also be a luau themed party for the class of 2017. I'd say our final goodbyes as we head off into college. And also, last week was the Academic Awards Night, which was a great showing in North Reading High School. I think it was upwards of 80 awards, ranging from leadership awards to science, math, and English. We had an incredibly high turnout with regards to the student body, and each and every day it's incredible to see the work that goes on with academics, extracurriculars, leadership that happens in the hallways of North Reading High School. Lastly, in sports, there's been a tremendous work on behalf of all sports teams at North Reading High School, especially in these last couple weeks, with girls track winning their state title Sunday, I believe, for the second year in a row, while boys track came in second place, with last year coming in third place. So there's been the boys, girls, and track team in the winter and spring months have just been phenomenal, with an incredibly high number of turnout each and every year. Onto lacrosse, the boys lacrosse team opened up today in the state tournament for the Division III North Sectionals, opening it up against Essex Tech. As I drove by, they had a 10-2 lead on Essex Tech in the third period. So if they win this game, they'll be playing Triton in the next few days. Softball will also be the number one seed in Division II North, I believe, in regards to softball, finishing with an 18-2 record. I'm not sure of their standings and schedule for their tournament. It just came out a few hours ago, so I apologize. With baseball, they will be opening up against Saugus on Saturday at 4 p.m. at home in the first round of Division III North Sectionals. And winning that game, hopefully, when we win that game, I should say, we'll be facing Linfield at Linfield next Sunday. So boys baseball, as you know, was fortunate enough to make it to the state championship last year, so hopefully we'll be able to have another great run. And lastly, sports awards for all spring sports will be held on June 6th, Tuesday, June 6th, in the high school auditorium. So,
is it for me, it's your report.
No student work?
No, I didn't.
What?
I apologize.
Any questions or comments for Dan?
When Dan says we in reference to the baseball team, he means we because he's one of the starting pitchers for the team. Are you starting that game?
We started Saturday.
Excellent. Good luck, Dan. Great job, by the way. Great job.
Science, minor in economics, and also partaking in Army ROTC as well.
Excellent.
They have any sports down there in
Alabama? They have pretty good football.
They do have pretty good football.
See you Saturday. Good luck.
Thank you.
Okay, next we're going to switch the agenda around and we're going to move to the middle school presentation, and for that we'll bring up Ms. Molly.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for being here, members of the transcript, and North Reading Kate.
NORCAM,
thank you. Always a pleasure to have everybody here at the Little School, and for all our students who are presenting and performing tonight, thank you all for being here. I know you probably have other commitments, and thank you for being here. I want to start off by saying this has been a particularly fabulous year at the Little School. We were under construction in one way or another for most of the year. We started the year with the roof project, which was completed in, I believe, early October. The PTO was diligently fundraising for the playground, and I can't thank the fundraising committee and the playground committee enough for the fabulous job they did in fundraising for that structure that I hope you got a chance to see out in the parking lot, because it's just wonderful, and it really brings tears to my eyes when I leave some days and there's 100 kids out there playing and all their parents standing there and socializing. So it's just wonderful. The playground was constructed the last weekend of April. Many of you were here. Again, thank you so much. And so our theme this year was construction. And it started out with bulletin boards that said, we're building a better team. We have minds under construction, building a better future for our children. And so you will see different things in the brochure tonight. Bulletin boards, we had t-shirts and construction hats when we started the school year off. All of the faculty came dressed, ready to construct a wonderful year. In addition to the playground and the roof project, the digital learning team and Mrs. Gomez, our art teacher, really, really worked hard to get our makerspace up and running. And it's just been a wonderful experience and so unbelievable to watch the children work in that environment and problem solve and work as a team. And so we hope to continue to expand upon the makerspace that we have in school. Thank you for those of you who have donated cereal boxes and paper towel rolls. And you can't imagine how important that stuff is in a makerspace. So thank you for all of your donations and hopefully your continued donations as we move forward. Tonight, a lot of people were a part of this evening, so I'd like to say thank you to many, many people here, in addition to all of our students and the parents that brought them here. I'd like to thank my third grade teaching staff, wonderful group of teachers who just are so collaborative and just, I can't say enough, Mrs. Maeve Bradley, Mrs. Kate Reed, and Mr. Phil Lynch. I actually made him take him down because he was quite calm. digital learning specialist, Sam Anthony, and our digital learning paraprofessional, Diane McGuire, who worked so diligently with the children to do their research and to really, you'll see some really fabulous technology stuff too that the kids are working on. So thank you for that. And Mr. Tager, oh, and what would be a visit to the little school without a musical presentation? Can't get out of here without that. So thank you to Mr. Tatro, wherever you are, Mr. Tatro, be well, and Mrs. Mazzoli. You will be getting a sneak peek of the opening number of the upcoming play, Madagascar, which is happening at the North Reading Middle School High School Performing Arts Center on June 16th and June 17th. So you're getting a sneak preview. Buy your tickets soon because I think they're almost sold out. So if you're planning on going, I encourage you to get your tickets soon. And thank you to all the faculty and staff members who came back after a long day of work to be here tonight. Greatly appreciated. And just thank you to everybody. How about that? All right, so we're going to start out the evening with Sam Anthony, digital learning specialist.
I have it as digital literacy. Are you doing digital literacy?
I am. Okay.
Good afternoon.
I'm going to ask,
oh, yes.
We might want to have the school committee come this way so that you can see the screen.
Good evening, everyone. Again, I'm Sam Anthony. I'm a digital learning specialist, one of the three working with the elementary grade levels. I was delighted to be asked to come tonight to present what we did during our whale unit with the students here at the little school in third grade. So in collaboration with the third grade teachers, we talked about how we can use technology to have the kids work as a team to bring in the communication, creative thinking, critical thinking, and communication into the use of technology with these kids. So we put together this web quest encouraging the kids to ask questions about real life issues. So what do whales face during their lifetime? And they had to answer a question using a piece of software called Socrative. And they had to do a brainstorming session. How does climate change, whaling, and pollution change the lives of marine mammals such as whales? So they had an opportunity to use iPads to answer the question and just do some free writing, which we went over. So we started the unit with that question, and then it was time to investigate. We put together this web quest, giving students access to all sorts of online resources and tools, and all they had to do was add this web quest to their Chrome account bookmarks, and they were able to access all this information using their Chromebooks. So within the investigation section, they had to learn about the problems that whales are facing. They had to read an online article. The Chromebooks allow us to have students who might struggle with reading have the article read to them. So that was a cool tool that we had. It's called Speak It. It's a Chrome extension. So from here, once they had learned about the dangers whales are facing, we had to then focus on just learning about facts. What do we need to know about whales and how can we help them? So using the wonderful resources that we have available here at North Reading, the students were able to gather information about their research questions using World Book Encyclopedia, Pebble Go, Britannica, Facts for Me. So they did some research, taking notes, reading online, and taking notes. And once they had completed their research, they knew that their task was to create a campaign so that we can save the whales. So they had to then create an infographic using Google Drawing, which we then We posted all around the school, raising awareness, teaching all the other students in the school about whales and how we need to help the whales survive. The other part of this was to create a video using the green screen that we have. And the campaign was then shared with families where they were going to donate some money so that we can actually adopt one of the whales from WDC. The students worked together as partners, and they had to write the script. So this is an example of the script that they had to work on, again using Chromebooks, collaborating together, working as a team. They had to learn about the dangers the whales are facing in today's world, what can we do to help them, and how they pledged to do some extra chores at home to raise money so that we can adopt one of the whales. Throughout this whole web quest, there are many different links to different places online that were reviewed by us so that the students could really get as much information as they could about the whales and how we could help. We then shared the campaigns, those videos that they had created with the parents through email. And I do have a sample of one of the videos that the kids created, but I'm not going to show that to you until after the kids have had a chance to talk. All the work was assessed through a rubric towards the end of the project, and they had a chance to really make a difference in the world. So I'm going to pass this on to
Hi, welcome to the Little School. I'm Catherine Wright. We really enjoyed our study of whales and would like to share some fun facts about the eight whales we researched.
A fun fact about beluga whales are that they use their facial expressions to communicate with one another.
Sperm whales have heads full of oil called spermaceti, which was highly valued by whalers many years ago. Right whales got their name from whalers. They named it the right whale because it was the right whale to hunt. The narwhal's tusk is actually a tooth. A long time ago, hunters would sell it as a unicorn horn. Great whales migrate the farthest of all whales. They travel as far as 13,700 miles round trip. Blue whales are the largest animal in the world. They are up to 90 feet in length. Humpback whales like to sing using whale calls. Killer whales use their tails to attack their prey. Sound is created by vibrations. Vibration is the back and forth movement of an object. Sound energy travels in the form of sound waves. There are two types of sound waves, transverse sound waves and longitudinal sound waves. An example of transverse sound waves can be seen when one person holds the slinky still while the other person shakes it up and down. The particles always vibrate at a right angle of the waves in a transverse sound wave. The sound energy travels from one whale to another in the ocean. This is transverse sound waves. An example of longitudinal sound waves can be seen when one person holds a slinky still while the other person pushes back to the other person. Particles also move from left to right. Those are longitudinal sound waves. In a solid, the particles are close together. Sound waves travel faster in a solid because sound energy moves as one particle hits another. The particles in a liquid are slightly farther apart. Sound energy takes longer when going through a liquid. Transverse and longitudinal sound waves are two examples of how whales communicate with one another. This is a unique way for whales to communicate. Many whales live in frigid ocean waters. Therefore, they need blubber to insulate their bodies for protection. The blubber is a 6-inch thick layer of fat under their skin. We are going to demonstrate how blubber works by using vegetable shortening in ice-cold water. We have placed the vegetable shortening in a double-lined Ziploc bag to make a basic glove. Catherine will place one hand in the bag and her other in the water without any protection.
You can see from the look on my face that my hand in the water with no protection is almost numb, and my hand that's in the bag with the protection is pretty much like normal.
I hope this basic demonstration helps you understand more about the benefits of whale blubber in basic whales.
Global warming has
phytoplankton populations of baleen whales eat. Some whale species are starting to come back, but some will never recover. For instance, there are only 400 right whales left in the ocean. After learning all about whales, we wanted to do something to save the whales. We learned about the whale and dolphin conservation. We visited their website and found out that we could raise money to adopt a whale. We decided to ask our parents to give us chores to do at home in exchange for money to save the whales. Altogether, the third graders raised $224, and we were able to adopt 3 orca whales and 1 humpback whale through the WDC. We learned a lot about whales, and we learned that we can make a difference. Thank you.
That's it.
So Scott's unable to be here tonight. He wanted to give his apologies for not being able to be here. And I also wanted to thank all the teachers and the staff and the parents and the kids. And I have to say, Mr. Tatro and what the music staff has done at our elementary schools, we already had a great department, music and drama department at the middle school and high school. It's so much better. It's great when we actually have money in the budget, we can afford to have kids singing and dancing and acting all the time. So thank you.
And it all starts here. It all starts here with the classics. Don't forget.
Until 2030, 2040.
Oh, Mr. Barrett?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Not an awful lot to update you on tonight since our last week, since your last meeting. I did want to just let you know that the drainage work, here's the system, are complete. The last information I have is that, you might recall, there's about a month settling period before they come back and do the, what's called the mandrel testing to test the efficiency of the system. That's scheduled right now to be on around June 19th. Again, some of you will recall that the original completion day, final completion, including all the paving of the significant amount of the access road from Park Street up to the campus is due to be repaved. There is a desire to maybe advance that deadline a little bit in our favor. I do anticipate Joanna Crick from Bill Bates on vacation. Hasn't been a lot of communication from them. Not faulting them for that, just that there hasn't been a lot of communication from us week. But I do want to make sure that when we do the final paving that the appropriate people are involved to make a decision as to whether or not the road, in fact, is ready to be repaved. We're not doing it too soon, but at the same time, I would like to try to have that done at least a little bit ahead of the August 15th deadline.
Don't forget, because of the paving and then you have the lining and
correct.
You wait too long. And,
and as you all know, that campus is a busy place. Right. And it's the middle of August, rolls around, and it's really, a lot of people think we're on summer vacation still, which we technically are, but sports start up and teachers are coming back and it's busy. So I'm confident that they will, the people that need to be involved will be working with them to schedule that for a date that's appropriate. The landscaping, quite honestly, I think, you know, we all had in our minds that May 30th was a kind of a deadline date for a lot of work being completed, but but I can tell you that I know that there are still a number of items that remain outstanding, specifically in the way of tree and shrub replacements, which were identified on the walkthrough on May 17th, which did occur shortly after your last meeting. I would say to you, my report reflects that there are about 20 such trees to be replaced. But there are some number of shrubs, particularly in the kind of rounded islands at both the main entrance to the school and the front plaza area, and also around the gym entrance at the rear of the school. So again, in the absence of some contact with Gilbane over the last week, I don't have any more information for you other than that. I can tell you that I have been fairly good at advocating our position. Sure they're not planting things in the summer again and then running the risk of losing them. So I think everyone's well aware of that. It's just a matter of making sure that it's done in the time frame that we need to soon. So. And that's really all I have, Mr. Chairman, for tonight.
Any further additions or comments or questions? I want to have some concern with some emails fly around regarding the warranty and the landscaping.
Yes.
And the things I was reading, concerned that I don't recall the SSBC accepting any of the landscaping yet. Yet I was reading that maybe there are warranties on some of the landscaping. Did you get any clarification on that?
No, I commented on the group and Mr. Bowers did too.
Yes.
And I would say that I think it's fair to say that I think the warranty is represented to be that we've got a year after the date of acceptance. And as far as I was concerned, nothing had been accepted, so that warranty should still run for a year. But it looked to me like that they were talking about June.
Right.
It was a warranty period.
With that,
but there's been no clarification based on the two emails.
Wasn't there something we accepted on the lower Mills area?
No, just the only thing that's not a warranty is the softball field being up hurt.
Because that was
we took that
outside of the warranty.
The drainage underneath is still a warranty, but the fields itself.
I thought there was something about the grass that was around the
still
that we accepted.
No, my belief right now is we've accepted nothing.
Okay.
And that includes all the plantings, the grass, and that once accepted, we extended by the years. But that was a kind of a group email.
Right.
And I saw nothing back. That was the new group from our school. Wednesday meeting. Thursday meeting.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Brown.
Sure.
Next, we have proposed summer reading schedule.
So, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. So I selected two dates. These are not, certainly not set in stone. The dates that I proposed are due. I think they do represent pretty much the same time that you met last year in July and August, just a new date, but not the end of August, excuse me, the end of July, and the end of August. So if those look good, we can plan for the goals workshop at 4:30, regularly at 6:30, but if those don't jive with your schedules for vacations or other obligations you have, I think we can certainly work to find something that's agreeable for everybody.
School committee is my top priority, so I'm going to put all my other questions on that. So
I don't have to worry about any of these things.
Well, until I schedule my vacations, I have to know what days.
You don't have to worry more about Cliff's doc and Gary Gates on the ground.
Right, right, that's right.
Now, vacation.
Yeah, that should be top priority.
All right, so this is okay, John.
Very good.
Is the new guy going to be here?
Mr. Buckley?
Yeah.
Is that his name, Buckley?
Yeah, what is the Buckley field?
Have you got him?
Yeah, no.
Did he review these dates, John?
He did. He commented to me over the weekend that they were fine. Yes, he did. He commented on a few things tonight, the next item on the agenda, that, and as well as item number. So, you did okay? Thanks, John.
Next item on the agenda is Foundation Budget Review Commission recommendations, a school committee resolution that I asked Mr. McCarr to put on the agenda. It's several school committees already passed this. It relates to the Foundation Budget Review Commission that was made up of, I think it was both state reps and state senators. There's been a lot of hemming and hawing, but the results, the recommendations came out around 2 years ago, showed that the state is between $1 billion and $2 billion a year short of funding the Chapter 70, which goes to cities and towns to help fund our school systems. And there has actually been some movement. There was a, I'll pass this around, there was an amendment passed by the Senate, so now it would go to a conference committee, which basically forces the legislature to put this act into place and to begin funding it on a phased-in basis. The two most important things for North Reading, and I spoke to Mr. Conley about this, where we would benefit is that currently the state significantly underestimates how much cities and towns spend on both special education and on health insurance. So when they look at a foundation budget, they have artificially low numbers for health insurance and for special education costs. So thus, they give us less money than they would have to give us if they were actually recognizing the real costs to cities and towns for those two major categories in our budgets. So this resolution basically asks the legislature and the governor to implement FBRC and begin funding it immediately. This amendment, which was passed unanimously by the Senate last week, I believe it was a 38-0 vote. The president of the Senate actually voted, and he usually doesn't vote, but the president of the Senate usually doesn't vote on items, would make sure that it gets funded, although it would be on a phased-in basis over 3 or 4 years. You know, bottom line for me is there's not enough, the state's having a hard enough money collecting tax revenues as it is right now. It's going to be about a half a billion short when this fiscal year ends. So they're not going to be able to fund it immediately. So I would just ask the committee to approve this resolution, and then I'll report it to Tracy Novick at Mass, who's been kind of compiling all of these. So if there's any questions or
Jim, if you don't mind, just I do have two original copies here.
Okay.
Mr. Buckley was very passionate about this. I think he's, you know, certainly supportive of it. So he did come in the office this morning to sign on, assuming that the committee, or I guess hoping that the committee will vote tonight to adopt this. So if that's the desire of the committee, I have the two copies here that we can sign. We can retain that in the office one that we sent to the three folks, the two legislators and representatives.
I think it's important for our committee to move forward with the resolution. I think it speaks volumes. The more school committees statewide that kind of make this their goal for the state to really kind of
town's struggling to keep up. Any other questions or comments? I have a motion to accept the resolution for the asking the Jackson Foundation, which asks Commonwealth of Massachusetts to implement without further delay in full recommendations of the foundation budget review.
Chair, I have a motion.
I'll motion.
Motion by Dean, second by Jerry. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Four in favor, one opposed. Oh, and you have the original, we'll sign it.
I have two, yep.
We'll just sign it after you.
Sure, remember that, it was two here. Thank you.
Okay.
Sorry.
Next, we have, good item to report, happy news. An update on all of the various contracts that we've negotiated the past 5-6 months with the various associations in North Carolina.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So, I think what I want to report on to you tonight, and actually, if you don't mind, I'm going to start kind of near the bottom, so on page 3, because the most recent information is that paraprofessionals, union did ratify terms of tentative agreement that had been reached, and also adopted the proposed contract. So I have copies here for signatures of the committee tonight. As far as the all of the contract negotiations that took place, as you said, I think we first met with all of our collective bargaining units that were due up this year for new contracts starting as early as December. And in summary, I would like to just add that I appreciate very much the respectful tone that took place in working with our custodians, with our secretaries, and with our paraprofessionals, and also the administrative group that includes the two assistant principals, the two special education coordinators, and what is the coordinator doing in learning. So I appreciate very much the tone of all of the conversations that were had among those employees, as well as the participation of the school committee members that represented various work groups in the negotiations, Mrs. Mariano and the custodians, Mrs. Coffey, the secretaries, and Mr. Webster, the paraprofessionals. So I'm very proud of the tone and the collaborative effort that took place over the meetings that we had over the last several months. I think we did a good job as far as representing the district on the challenges, the fiscal challenges that are related to fiscal year 18. I appreciate the employees understanding of the realities of where we were at. So what I try to do in my report to you tonight is identify for you what I think are the kind of the overall and salient points of what had been reached. And I'm just going to want to read through those and just
sure.
With the custodians. We reached a 3-year contract that would be starting on July 1st of 2017 through June 30th of 2020. With cost of living adjustments of 1%, 2%, and 2%, respectively, in each of those 3 fiscal years. With the Secretaries Association, very similar. We also reached a 3-year contract, July 1, 2017 through June 30, 2020, with cost of living adjustments of 1%, 2%, and 2% in each of the 3 fiscal years, fiscal year 18, 19, and 20, respectively. We also did see fit for a $300 increase to longevity increments, and also were able to limit longevity benefit for all employees that are hired on or after July 1st of 2017.
So, Ms. Brenner, if I could there, you know, I'm not a big fan of increasing some of the benefits like longevity, but in this case, in the long term, this is a big deal because any new staffers, any new secretaries coming on after this date, after July 1st, 2017, you no longer qualify for some of these incentives, bonuses, the longevity.
And I agree with that. Although these contracts are going to increase the longevity, we've already had longevity.
That's correct.
Yes. So we're just increasing the amount.
Yes.
So we're not adding longevity. That's a really valid exchange for basically getting rid of the hires and making it work for the investment.
In this case, it works. It continues along our strategy, which I think we've made made a lot of progress over the years of limiting many benefits that were put in when we weren't able to pay staff at the schools the way they should have been paid. I'm not saying that everybody paid the perfect salary now, but there was a time when budgets were so low that we just weren't able to pay staff. And you know, one of the things that all school districts did was adding benefits such as longevity, sick day buyback, you know, talk about it.
I would just add to that point, so that it's not missed, we're not mentioning about the custodian longevity that had been phased out prior to contract. With the paraprofessionals, very similar in that, again, a three-year contract, July 1, 2017 to June 30, 2020, possibly adjustments of 1%, 2%, 2% in each of the three fiscal years, 2018, 19, and 20. $300 increase in longevity agreement. We were able to work with the paraprofessionals to really simply buy that benefit for employees hired on or after July 1st of 2017. So it's a little conversation just a minute ago. With the Administrators Association, similar, the 2017 to 2020 3-year contract with the cost of living adjustments, fiscal years 18, 19, 20, 1%, 2%, 3%. Longevity benefit in those contracts.
Yeah, I'll take that.
Do you want that?
I appreciate it. What we extended Mr. Bernard's contract a year, so it'll run through June 30th, 2020. We also gave him for 1% for fiscal 18, for 1% for fiscal 19, for 2% for fiscal 19, and 2% for fiscal 20. And we're also, John never received an increase for fiscal 2017. Because we were in the middle of his review cycle. So we held off on the increase. So we are awarding John a 2% increase that's retroactive to that. And I think, I have to say that negotiations are never easy, but I think in the end, all of the associations and all the administrators realize that money doesn't flow freely when it comes to municipal budgets. And I believe, Mike, that we pretty much came in right where we expected to come in on budget for these.
Right, a little bit under, actually under the allotted salary rule that we budgeted.
So that was the same.
Not much.
Not much.
Not much. You know, just underneath. So we came in budget. It's a lot of work there.
So do we need a motion
Yes.
Okay. Yes. So at this time, I will enter a motion to approve a 3-year contract running from July 2017 through June 2020 for the North Reading Custodians.
Chair, I'd like to make a motion to accept the North Reading Custodians contract as described.
Second. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? 4-0 with one absent. Now for the motion for the Secretaries Association.
I didn't know if you wanted to do
it. Oh, sure. Mr. Chairman, I'd like to motion that we be accept the 3-year contract from 2017 to 2020 with the North Reading School Secretaries Association.
I'll second it.
Motion by Julie, second by Denise. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? 4-0 with one absent. Next, the Federation of Paraprofessionals.
Chair, I'd like to make a recommendation to accept the North Reading Federation of Paraprofessionals contract as stated.
Motion by Janine, second by you. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? 4 in favor, 1 absent. North Reading Industries Association.
Chair, I'd like
discussion. favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Four in favor, one absent. Thank you, everybody.
Congratulations to all the players except for myself.
We have.
Next
year, we have the seniors.
Correct.
But it's good to get
done with everything.
The bulk of it, yes, all of our contracts are done. I'd like to commend the administration.
It was a very good, I have to say, it was a very good experience.
A lot of the play did it, that's a lot.
Yes, absolutely.
It was interesting having them all, or having not all, but having this many ones, but it was good process. So thank you.
Okay, routine matters. We have minutes. I think all we have is all we have is objectives.
That's the only one right now.
I read through it, looked fine to me, so if anybody has any questions or comments or someone wants to make a motion.
Chair, I'd like to make a motion to accept the executive minutes of March 27th.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Four in favor, one absent. Okay, next, we have budget update.
Yes, thank you. So there is a budget update in the packet this evening. The main budget report that essentially summarizes financial activity through the middle of May or the third week in May. And I will say there's not a lot of new information in this report than what we reported last month or the prior few months, but really at this point in the year, we approach the final 30 days of the fiscal year. We are essentially in the process of closing out the fiscal year, renewing all of the encumbrances, and making sure we're in good shape to close out the year well. As I have mentioned throughout the process and throughout the FY18 budget development process, as we've done in the past, we are beginning to prepare special education tuition prepayments. We look at the report, those amounts aren't reflected yet in the report, but we are gathering those and we anticipate encumbering those and starting that process in the very near future. So at this point, we are very hopeful that we will be able to meet, if not exceed, the $125,000 amount that we did budget for during the FY18 budget development process. The report still reflects the utility expenses have been kind of fully encumbered at this point. We've got to begin the process later this week in reviewing all our utilities as the May invoices come in at the end of the week. At that point, we'll be able to make adjustments to these encumbrances, and as I have reported in the past, we expect there will be a small amount, and particularly in the gas budget, that we have available to reapportion elsewhere. We'll begin that process shortly. As I've reported in the past, we did experience some unanticipated expenses in the building maintenance costs this year, particularly around some HVAC door issues that we had to address throughout the district as well as the middle school and high school. But as I've said, we've been able to manage these costs to date, and I'm hopeful that that will be the case over the final 30 days here. We've been getting some monthly updates on the food service program. I'm happy to report that we closed out the month of April with a small profit of $2,859.08. This puts the program's total net loss through the month of April at a little over $11,700. We are still anticipating or projecting a net loss closer to around $7,900 by the time we close out this fiscal year. We are experiencing some positive news in May. We haven't closed out May yet. We expect to have a profit in May, or maybe a potential loss in the short month of June, and seniors graduating and so forth. So we are hopeful we'll meet that target of around $7,900 loss in the food service program. On the payroll side, there's really nothing significant to report. If you look at the report, obviously it appears that we'll have some available funds and some of the salary accounts that we'll be able to repurpose. This will also help assist with meeting our special education prepayment needs that we have budgeted during fiscal 18. We have some additional funds available in the substitute budget. Really, it's happy to report that we haven't had the need to expend the long-term substitute costs and need to fill long-term leave of absences that we've had to in the past. But I think at this point we are in pretty solid financial standing to close out the fiscal year, achieve those carryover funds that we had forecasted during the FY18 budget process. So with that, I'll turn it over to questions.
Any questions, comments, or questions? I have one, Michael Lundy. On the utility expenses, one thing that concerns me is we had a fairly warm winter. Do you have any concern that you maybe got more favorable bills than you might have expected because of the warm winter? And if we had an average winter, they might have been higher. So I'm a little worried about that, but I think I don't want to get a false sense of security about the utility going into next year.
Yeah, I think as you know, things are definitely tighter than they have been. We made some increases to the electricity budget because of the rate going up, and we did some water analysis of the usage. The gas usage has been pretty solid. We are locked in at a pretty favorable rate next year. We had kept that budget amount steady. We didn't increase the budget amount next year. But we actually, given that the fact that the final year of our gas contract is a floating year, and we locked in a few months ago at a lower rate than we were paying this year. So the rate that we're paying in gas next year is actually lower. It will help. So I think we'll be okay. It's certainly something to watch and pay close attention to this year.
Okay. Thanks. Next we have staffing update.
Do you understand?
Pretty good size of tires.
Yeah.
We haven't seen in quite a while.
Yeah, I think if you get the math right, I think we have 12 people retiring. There's actually one very recent retiring, not up to make your list, with a total of 241 years of service in the district. So that's pretty remarkable. So we have a number of very good long-standing employees in the district retiring, mostly at the end of the year, although Lil Deason at the high school did retire, mediation retired on February 4th, 2017. But we have Kathy Pigeon with 33 years of service in the district, special ed teacher at the Batchelder School. Claudia Brown with 19 years, phys ed and health teacher at the high school. Robin Clark, an occupational therapist with 10 years of service. Mary Jane Skahan, 14 years as a special education teacher at the high school, and Sylvia Wise, 20 years as a school psychologist at the middle school, and as I said, really amazing. We have a number of paraprofessionals, Laura Franson with 23 years of service here at the middle school, and also Julie Lassise with 12 years at the middle school. Jean Hansen with 25 years at the Batchelder School as a para, and Heidi McLaughlin with 14 years as a para also at the Batchelder School. And Linda Zulo just submitted her letter on Friday with a kind of a late announcement of retirement, 17 years of service as a para in the middle school. And Chuck Pepper is sort of retired. He's retiring in July, but he's applied for the part-time van driver position that we did through the consolidation. So it's looking good for Chuck to join us for about a 15-hour early position once school starts up in September. But he is officially retiring from his full-time position after 24 years in the district. Custodian and also a transportation driver for students with special needs. So.
Is Lily sure about that name?
Right. Lily is gone, but not forgotten.
Okay.
She
won't be forgotten.
She is gone.
I hope she'll be in graduation.
I'm not expecting her to graduate.
Oh, really?
Well, she was one of the longest servers, so she was kind of at the head of the line.
Good person.
Right. Well, some very, very good dedicated employees in time.
Thank you all for our ideas of service and commitment to the right. And wish them well out there.
Yes.
So next we have bids and donations. Well, let's take things back. Julie, okay.
So I just make the motion that this will be able to accept a gratitude donation in the amount of $169.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? In favor?
This is a motion to approve to accept a gratitude donation in the amount of $247.24 from the Little Elementary School PTO
We will have a year-end report for you probably at the July meeting. So you need to be able to see if you can provide some tracking. As you know, it's significantly generous.
Okay, next we have subcommittee updates. And I believe the athletic subcommittee, Barry Warner.
Yeah, I'll start off. Just a common report on the revolving, athletic revolving account. It looks like we should finish with a balance of between $16,000 and $17,000.
Yeah.
For the fiscal year, which is a little bit more than originally anticipated. We talked about, again, the status of the project down below the sod and the irrigation. And I think we were able to reduce it, correct me if I'm wrong, John, Mike, we were able to reduce the amount of shot fall to fund those fields by about $10,000.
That's right.
Okay. And we applied some of the money, if you remember correctly, the we used some of that money, I think about $14,000, Andrew, to pay back the deficit that we had for the project down below. We also dedicated some of that money, about $3,800, to the farming arts microphones. We tried to prioritize what's left to do down there as far as equipment. We do have some goals down there. Soccer goals, which is another one priority. It's about $1,700 to purchase the soccer goals. Next priority, we talked about the electricity going out to the area of the softball field for a future scoreboard, and also potentially using machines or whatever out there as well. And then a priority is a softball bag, and just similar to one that's adjacent to the baseball field. And we also talked again about the dugout canvas coverings, which Bonnie Tilton and Dave Johnson are kind of looking into and trying to get across and trying to get something that will work down there with the dugouts. Softball fields we do for most of the season.
It's great, yeah. Nothing but positive.
Yeah, I've had an opportunity to talk to coaches in high school team, and they absolutely love it down there. And the field is being used almost on a nightly basis by softball as well. So generally, the varsity finishes up down there, and the youth teams, some youth teams are drawn afterwards. I think we also talked, and I'll turn it back to Mel to update us on the laboratory facilities. June 2nd town meeting's coming up next Monday, and I think that's what we're going to probably open up a little bit tonight. So.
Tomorrow day, I mean, for the restroom facility and also hopefully the concessions facility down at the turf field. Tomorrow night, we're actually going to be having an information session at the high school library. Rita Mullen has invited members of the Booster Club to use the concession stand, come down, just give an informational update. We made it clear, learn from any decisions made. We're not going to take any input from people and put something on the town meeting on Monday night. We just want people to be aware of where things stand. The RFP went out, then we opened on Monday. There's a committee that will be there Thursday. There'll be a committee that are open. First, the non-price bids, which are basically just descriptions of the work that we've done. We then grade those bids to see what they need for the next round, and do all the qualifications, and then we open the price bids. It's not a public bid opening. It's an RFP. It's different than a public bid opening. We had a lot of interest from companies taking the specs out, going to the online site, and downloading the specs. That doesn't mean we're going to get a lot of bids, but there were probably 15 or so.
A lot of interest, yeah.
Right. A lot of interest, and I think a big part of that was, one, we gave them an extra week to do, put the bid together, and two, we told them we didn't have to be finished until March 15th of next year. At first, we were looking for a completion by the end of August,
for the football season. That's fine.
So I think one thing that will mean, and then this will have to be discussed with the town health, head of the health department town. The concession stand will still be there in the fall. So we have to figure out exactly what he's going to allow the boosters to use that for. I believe one thing Marty Tilton has been talking about is bringing this portable kind of sink system that has a water tank that can, I believe, can have a pipe full of water with it to wash dishes and stuff like that. I know that the health agent has been comfortable with us using grills but no cooking from scratch. So hopefully we'll be able to work that out so concessions and facility will be used by the nurseries this fall. Our goal is to have everything, whatever we can get approved, if we get approved, town meeting completed by March 15th for the spring season of next year, 2020. Meeting tomorrow is at 6 o'clock at the high school library. The bid, the RFP opening is at 11 o'clock. That'll be at the town hall. And then on Friday at 3 o'clock, there'll be a joint meeting between the CIPC and the Athletic Facilities Committee to go over those bids. The last time we canceled the meeting because it was one day and it was deemed unacceptable.
That means in the DLL.
Correct. That means in the DLL on Friday at 3 p.m. Regardless of whether we get enough bids, we get bids or not, there will be that meeting. Because we're going to have, if we don't get bids, we're going to have to discuss what we're going to do going forward. If we do get bids, there's likely going to be a recommendation made. One thing that was interesting, some of the bids, some of the companies that took out, that downloaded the specs, were maybe looking at different types of buildings. There are also some equipment companies that kind of have these kind of pre-made buildings for restrooms and concession stands. So the hope is we get more interest.
So will the subcommittee bring a recommendation on Friday for the CIPC?
I, as a representative of the committee opening the bids, I hope my goal is to have a recommendation for a project and the cost at that meeting on Friday. And then the selectmen, the finance committee will discuss that on Monday night before town meeting. The school committee will discuss that
Monday
before town meeting, and make a recommendation. That's the hope. I did want to point out another thing. There's been a discussion about the scoreboard, and I'm not going to give details with Mr. Bernard, and I have had some discussions that Mr. Bernard has been working some back channels, and hopefully, we'll see. There may be something
that we're meeting on the 15th.
Is the challenge?
Yeah, so hopefully, something might come of that. I'm hopeful. I did also have a couple of other things, updates on since our meeting on Tuesday, if you don't mind.
Right.
So we did get the quote today for the soccer goals, so we're going to move forward with purchasing those.
Okay.
And then Michael and I met with Wayne Hardiker on Friday morning.
Yeah.
With our electrician, and we revisited the original quote for a power source for the scoreboard, just to make sure that that quote's about 6 months old. So we wanted to just get him on board with the likelihood that, we're going to move forward with that as a priority, because we know the scoreboard is, you know, eventually that's going to happen. I'm hoping sooner rather than later, but we want to have the power already to go. I also asked him to quote for us bringing another power source out to the field, somewhere in the area of the almost where the bleacher pad ends on first base and before the large sliding gate. And just, you know, we need another power source, I think, on the other side of that field.
What about, can we talk about the third base too?
So I think to do that is beyond anything we could conceive of.
Yeah, we may have to readjust our thoughts on that.
Where we going to maybe?
We asked him to do, these are three quotes. So we're looking at the one quote for the scoreboard to be updated. I'm not sure if there'll be a change or not. The second power source, and then we asked him also to price out, of course, drawing power to the garage, the maintenance area actually, which designed that sort of thing. So we met about a half an hour or so. I think we left him in the wings, it was about 40 degrees on
Saturday. No, it's 6:30 degrees.
But, so that's in the works too.
Other question about the soccer quotes?
17:30.
One of the things is, you know, I hate to sound like the constant, I sound like the, always begging for money, but, we would actually like two sets of soccer goals because all-purpose field will allow us to practice on both sides. So you can have two teams practicing at once, if that's how big it is.
Potentially three to practice.
So if there's any youth organizations, anybody out there listening who says, I got a few spare dollars in my pocket, I think I'll throw them to the school department so they can buy the equipment they're looking for the all-purpose field. for the softball field. And I mention this a lot, but I don't think it can ever be mentioned enough that those two fields down there were completed for approximately $150,000 without 1 cent from the taxpayers. So I know people are looking at the restroom and concession stand, and we don't want to spend that money. Well, you could have spent $150,000 more if we had had the taxpayer money for those fields. And there's been other things done without taxpayer money. So we're trying to do it without taxpayer money. The concession, and we're also actually, Rita and I have been talking, and I know Rita's been talking to Michael, but if we can't get a concession stand approved, we're going to try to look at maybe there's some other ways to do it where we can get a community project or something. I don't know if that's possible, but we're looking at all angles to try to get this done within the most reasonable budget.
We've come to the realization, too, depending on how many bids we actually get, but that there's a cost associated with the restroom facilities, and we're going to have to probably pay whatever that is, because we have to have the facilities.
At some point, we can't keep putting it up.
Cost is the cost, and as Mel has mentioned several times at our meetings, if you're looking at some other districts that pay for those types of facilities, it's quite reminded of what we're looking at. So.
While we're at that subject, I want to praise all the spring teams, but I especially want to praise the two main coaches of the track teams, Mr. Skinny and Mr. Gonzalez. Our track teams have become a juggernaut. It's a dynasty. The girls won the state championship division four, the boys came in second. They both won the state relay championships. They both won the AAMB championships. Track, when I've been in this town for one new player in around 35 years, but track was a forgotten sport for a long time. There's always some good track athletes, but it didn't have a focus, and these two coaches really brought a focus to that sport that you really need. And you see the enthusiasm of the kids. I just look at the pole vault and what we've done in the pole vault. There was a great picture. I saw a great picture of Jensen Payman, one of our students.
Who won it? No, place.
Jensen plays second and third.
Second.
Rachel Hill won on the girls' side. On the girls' side of the pole vault, the top eight, which was 3.5 or 6, were both right.
But again, I want to emphasize that we have provided these kids, these coaches, with some great facilities.
Right.
Many high schools do not have pole vaulting facilities. We have it. We have the discus area. We have the shot put area. We have the pole vault. We've got some great facilities now for the kids, and they're really taking advantage of them.
You stand up in that distance learning lab as we did last week, and you look down on the athletic facilities. It's like a D3 college. It's better than probably some
degree in VMA. It looks so good, I just hate that kids.
I don't even want
to use it. It looks so good. But they, the track teams, I saw it at CD yesterday, actually. And it goes to show you, too, a lot of it has to do with the coaches.
They get the kids out. These are kids that are stars in other sports.
Yeah.
Many of the stars from our other main sports are running track and moving in the spring.
And the girls won that state championship on the very last event of the day. By one point. So
they finished third in the 4x4.
They had a victory.
Right. In the 83 by 1 point.
Yeah.
So
they're equally good teachers too.
Yes.
Yeah.
They really are. And I think that is a plus. Kids out for school.
Anybody want to comment on the May 23rd secondary school building committee meeting? I'm not going to comment on it.
I don't think that.
There's not much we can say. Other than Mel got kicked.
I would have liked to have participated in the executive session, but I was deemed not suitable.
You had to be there.
I'm still trying to understand that decision. I'm sure someday I will. The wisdom will come to me. Administrative report, Mr. Bernard.
Yes, thank you. Just one item. I think I left you all a report. I just want to share with you my spring newsletter, March newsletter for the 2016-17 school.
Did you take that picture on the pedagogue?
I did not. No.
Because you could have taken it around.
I painted it down south. I painted it. That's an original painting. So I just want to share a copy with you.
This alone is just,
thank you.
With all the other resources that you provide for people, I don't want to hear.
correspondence at this time?
I have no correspondence, Mr. Chairman.
Did you jump over the dates for the subcommittee meetings?
Yes, I did. Finance planning is, oh, this Friday, 8:30. Athletic facilities, we mentioned, June 2nd, 3, this is our lab. And the athletic subcommittee, June 20th, in this conference room. And then future business town meeting is Monday night at 7 p.m. at the Performing Arts Center. The school committee will be meeting at 6:30 in the superintendent's conference room. June 9th is graduation, or commencement. And the school committee members are asked to be there at 5:45. Commencement begins at 6:15. Regular meeting of the school committee, June 12th. And then the final meeting before our summer schedule kicks in will be June 19th, both of the meetings at the business learning lab.
Chair, can I say something?
Well, I don't know what
everyone wants. I will not be present for the graduation, so I just wanted to send out the best wishes to all the graduating students this year.
You're going to be next year, you can actually be our graduates?
I think you will.
Okay.
Yeah, I will. You're on there. Are we going to be down to like 2 members? I mean, there's a new guy that I haven't seen yet.
Scott said he'll be back.
He lives in the district.
Does he?
Yeah.
But he'll be back.
He'll be back as well.
Sure?
Yes.
All right.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you.
Anything else tonight?
I just need signatures.
Okay. So with that, I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So late.
All in favor?
Aye.